Silverstone, the home of British motor racing, plays host to the fourth round of the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo this weekend. It's race two here at Silverstone after the double header at Monza. And yesterday's race was won by Patrick Kujala, the man who had dominated both races at Monza. And he very much is the man to beat at the moment, graduating indeed from single-seaters to GT cars for this year. So it's a whole new discipline for him, but Kujala treating this as though he'd been racing in sports cars for a long, long time. He did yesterday have to work pretty hard to rebuild the lead after he was badly held up in traffic towards the end of the race, and he had a fast-closing Patrick Niederhauser breathing down his neck, but well, it mattered, so the leader, Patrick Kujala, was able to build that gap up once more. He was able to take a third win of the season, and here he will start on pole position, not necessarily by dint of a race result, but because of the separate qualifying session for this second race. The format is the same as you are familiar with if you follow the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo. It's not changed for this weekend at all. It's 50 minutes of racing. There's a pit stop between 20 and 30, and the cars have to be stationary for 60 seconds. There for pole is the Bernardi Motorsport car in the hands of Patrick Kujala, and he is the man to beat. Three on the bounce for the Flying Finn. Very impressive indeed. And although he was very frustrated about the back markers yesterday, not just a corner he was held up for, but about three laps, really, he was able to keep his head together and come through and take the win. Patrick Niederhauser, who chased him hard yesterday, will start today rather than do the closing stint. He will open, as it were, for Raton Racing. So it's going to be fascinating to see whether Niederhauser is able to do anything at all about getting himself ahead of Kujala, something that nobody has done yet this year. Kai Cozzolino heads to the grid. He's a graduate of the Silverstone Race School, so he knows his way around this place, and he slots into position. Forms up then in number 16, and Cozzolino is on the outside of the third row of the grid, so he's going to be one to watch, as ever, with his co-driver Shinya Michimi, who is also very, very quick, as we saw both yesterday and indeed in the opening races at Monza. Kai Cozzolino will do the first stint behind the wheel, and there the rest of the grid starts to form up. We have 31 cars this weekend, so a championship that really has come on a pace over the last two or three seasons. Now record grids and the days of a handful of cars and a guest car to boost the entry long gone. Lots of things have changed, really. Not only the car for this year with this new mighty Huracan, this 5.2-litre V10 engine car, but also the fact that there is no Pro Cup anymore as such. The Pro Cup that we have now caters for young career single-seater racers rather than the good old boys like a Peter Cox, for example, that we used to have. And one of those up-and-coming pros is Patrick Kujala. He's on the grid with OJ Borg.
Patrick, it was a win yesterday, but a very frustrating one for you.
After thinking about it, I regret something what I said, but hopefully today everything will work perfectly and they will respect the blue flags and everything will go well.
You've been so dominating in this series so far. Is that going to continue today?
Fingers crossed, hopefully, yes.
What has been the secret of your success then? Because you have led every race so far.
If I say it, then maybe people will reduce the gap, so I will be quiet.
There, keep your cards close to your chest. Patrick, good luck for today.
Thank you.
Keeping your powder dry or something is the good old phrase. So Patrick Kujala isn't going to let anybody in on that secret. Part of it is his ability. Part of it is the fact that Bernardi Motorsport is a good team. But of course, it's a new car for this year, the Huracan. Mighty bit of kit. These race versions are the two-wheel drive. The road cars are four-wheel drive. And the teams have had to invest in a new car for this season. I asked Giorgio Sana on Friday, who's the boss of Lamborghini Motorsport, how long did it take to convince the teams to invest in an all-new car after they had all this money tied up in the Gallardo? He said, three laps. That's all it needed. Drivers came out with a huge smile on the face and said, that is what I want to race. There are still some of the Gallardos around. There's a separate AM class, indeed, for those cars. And they will be running, admittedly, towards the back of the grid, but having their own private contest. So it's good that the entry still caters for them. And I suspect they'll find their way into domestic GT championships in the future. But they're not being cast out just yet. There is a class ready for them. And in time, those drivers and teams, no doubt, will move to a Huracan, which is the latest car. Lamborghini, with its own in-house motorsport department these days, the Squadra Lamborghini Corsa, and instead of motorsport activity being done as an extra job for somebody, there is this standalone department, and it's being run very effectively with a young driver program as well, taking people from this into GT3 racing with a European Lamborghini Super Trofeo, one in Asia of course and one in America as well. So the whole motorsport program is looking very good indeed these days, and Lamborghini's brand being enhanced as a result. Florin Spengler, number 33, the Bernaldi Motorsport teammate to Patrick Kujala, will start on row three. He's with OJ.
Florin, it seems like the Lamborghinis have brought the sunshine out here, sort of at Silverstone. A dry track is probably what you want.
Yeah, definitely, because I never drove here in wet conditions, so would be nice if it stays like this. Yeah.
How are these Huracans in the wet, if you've driven one?
I only drove once in the wet, and it's, yeah, if you have the right line, you'll be fast. If not, you're slow.
So what's the plan for today then? You're on the right side of the track, but a few rows back.
Yeah, yesterday I was on the left, and I was not so good at the start. So today I be more focused and try to, yeah, look forward, not to crash or do some mistakes. So keep pushing.
Crashing's not what you want to do. Thank you very much, Florian.
You're welcome.
Yesterday, Florian Spengler was saying on the grid he was all focused for the race, but actually dropped back a little bit to begin with. He had to work his way through as the race wore on. In the end, he did make progress indeed, and Spengler finished in fourth spot. But the real gainers in the second stint, Sergio Campana and Fabrizio Crestani, because they were able to work their way into contention very definitely yesterday. And it was a result that shuffled a bit towards the end as well, because there was the car, we'll counter it on the grid shortly, of Harald Schlegelmilch, that was quick at the start when he put his co-driver in, and the co-driver is Mikhail Stepanov not as fast, and so he dropped down the order, and that shuffled things towards the end. Now today they do it differently, they put Stepanov in first, Schlegelmilch will go second, and that perhaps is the better way, because you always need your quick driver in at the end just in case there's a safety car period. Another team to watch today, Jay Palmer and Matteo Bobby. They used to race together in British GT going back a few years, when Matteo Bobby ran the sort of satellite Vita41 Ferrari team in the championship. They've teamed up in Lamborghinis this year, and they had a puncture yesterday which ruined the race, but if everything is good today, then they should be one to watch as well within the Pro-Am class. Marco Bortolotti was a front runner last year. He's on the grid to talk to us today as well.
Marco, you're here this weekend driving in the Blancpain, but you drove in this last season. It is a great series, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And this year, obviously, with the new cars, with the Huracans, it's even better. The field is quite competitive, many cars on the grid, so it's very nice racing. Always good to come back on the grid to see old friends, and hopefully we have a good race here in Silverstone, and I'm sure that they will do well.
I was just watching you walk down the grid wearing, you've got your race suit on. If somebody jumped out, do you think you'd just jump in and have a quick go?
Yeah, of course. I would definitely do it. I love that car. I was, let's say, part of the development last year, and it's really good fun to drive it, really quick, really fast, and so if anybody wants me to drive, I'll jump back in again.
And how is the Huracan looking? Because obviously you're driving the GT3 Huracan. How's it feeling?
It feels really good. Also the GT3, I mean, we did a good job there. The car is really fast, really good. And hopefully we'll have a good race this afternoon, starting from P6. The team is doing a great job. Have good teammates, so everything is set for the race.
Well, it seems like the clear in the grids for Bega off. Marco, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Have fun.
Marco Bortolotti then, who is part of the GT3 Huracan programme. He's one of the Lamborghini young drivers, makes his way off the grid, not been able to find an empty car, so frustrated he has to wait a little bit longer before he can go racing today. So we have on the front of the grid Patrick Kujala and Patrick Niederhauser, the second row, Sergio Campana and Daniel Zampieri, the third row, Florian Spengler on the inside. On the outside is Kai Cosolino, number 16, as Alberto Di Falco's gold Raton racing car comes next, alongside Jay Palmer. Then you've got Alberto Cerqui in the silver and green car that was knocked into a spin yesterday by the car alongside that of Gerhard Trevisan. Rafael Giannoni will go first next, with Adrian Amstutz alongside, then Simone Pellegrinelli and Marco Moscato alongside. Next up comes Cedric Lima, the green car of Jürgen Krebs that was a bit pesky yesterday, got in the way of quick cars when being lapped. Shota Abkazava's green car is next, alongside number 2 Mikko Eskilinen. Then the green car of Mikhail Stepanov, wait for Schlegelmilch to get behind the wheel of that. He's alongside Spiridonov, ahead of Sergio Montes and Marki Naikin. Andras Josefsson's Gallardo is alongside the similar car of Neil Huggins. Jacopo Faccioni's red and white car is alongside the Gallardo of Davide Dorante. Then you get Cyril Lima, the blue car of Tim Richards, which had damage yesterday. Nima Candania's car is red and white, alongside him Christoph Lenz. And there is Karina Lima at the back of the grid. That gives you 31 cars ready to go, with some spots of rain falling on the Camberlens as well. We've had a bit of rain this morning here at Silverstone. What a sight that makes. 31 Lamborghinis ready to go. In fairness, it's not just the sight they make, it's the sound as well as they storm away from the line. It is a rolling start, and so we are just about in business. 50-minute race. Everybody gets away now. At the end of this lap, they don't stop on the grid. It's a proper mini GT Enduro, therefore, so they go into the rolling start. Mandatory pit stops in the 20 to 30-minute window. And away from the back goes Corina Lima, who had a class win with Andrea Palmer at Monza. So everybody off the line. And, of course, this is an opportunity to get some warmth into the Pirelli rubber. And then at the end of the lap, we will go racing the Lamborghini pace car, as it is at the moment, leads the round Maggots up towards the Beckett's S's. On board here with Kai Cozzolino, the Japanese driver, standing on the brake to try and urge some warmth, not just into them, but then through into the tyres as well. Cozzolino, who is an Italian, but born in Tokyo, came, as I said earlier on, via the Silverstone Race School a decade ago. He then raced in Formula Toyota and Japanese Formula 3 and Formula Nippon. He's had a go in the World Touring Car races at Macau in the past. So an experienced driver is Cozzolino, but moving to the GT style of racing for this year. Another of the Lamborghini junior drivers. 69 is British club racer Nima Khandania with his red car that he shares with Jake Rattenbury, who's been a regular in this championship for the last couple of years. And so the car's working their way down Hangar Straight. Single brand race is no stranger to Silverstone. The Super Trofeo has been a regular visitor here over the years, but never with a grid this size. And the championship now really has come of age. And the fact that it's poaching teams like Conrad from other brand championships like Porsche Racing, very impressive indeed. The fact that it's attempting career racing drivers as well from GP3 level, for example, like Kujala, like Niederhauser, across into this, impressive as well. And so the championship still does look out for the amateur who wants to go racing at nice circuits and have good hospitality, but also it is a place where young racing drivers can come, learn about GT racing, and if they impress enough, be picked up as part of the young driver program that Lamborghini operates. The grid then, Kujala on pole, Niederhauser will line up alongside him. The second row of the grid, Sergio Campana, and then Daniel Zampieri, who retired yesterday, mechanical woes there. Third row, Florian Spengler and Kai Cozzolino, with the fourth row being Alberto Di Falco, who had a spin yesterday, and Jay Palmer. The fifth row of the grid is Alberto Cerqui and Gerhard Trevisa. Next on the grid, you find Raffaele Giannone and then Adrian Amstutz, ahead of Simone Pellegrinelli and Marco Moscato, who is going to start from 14th on the grid. He's ahead of Cedric Lima in the car that he will share with Laurent Jenny, and alongside him is Jürgen Krebs. Then you go back to the Georgian driver, Shota Abukazava. He lines up alongside the Finn, Mikael Eskelinen. Then comes Mikhail Stepanov, leaving Harald Schlegelmann with a bit of work to do from 19th on the grid alongside Mikhail Spiridonov. Then it is Sergio Montes alongside the Conrad Run car of Mark Inaichen. Andros Josefsson is next, 23rd on the grid. He had a spin yesterday. Newcomer, the Brit Neil Huggins, lines up 24th for the Top Cats team, ahead of Jacopo Faccioni and Davide Doranti, class winner at Monza. Cyril Lima comes next on the grid in his Gallardo alongside Tim Richards, who was involved in an incident yesterday when he moved across on Cozzolino and they both got damage. Nima Khandania and Christoph Lentz are on the penultimate row ahead of the shared car of Corina Lima and Andrea Palmer. Calvin Snooks will take over there, number two, the Mad Croc car from Mikko Eskelinen. One of the many Leipert run cars, Leipert, Bonaldi, for example, and Vincenzo Sospiri's team among the top squads in the championship. Raton Racing runs the car there, that's second on the grid for Patrick Niederhauser. And so now the cars get themselves in the 2x2 Noah's Ark style formation as they come out of Aintree onto Wellington Straight, and a fine sight they make. The pace cars, it is, will dive for the pit lane and they will be good to go. This is Cozzolino's view. He's on the outside of the third row of the grid. And a glorious noise as he accelerates and then brakes to generate the warmth in the tyres and brakes. Down they come then, through Brooklands, and in a moment, once they've worked their way around Luffield, the pace car will head for the pit lane, and then we are going to be in business for round four of the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo. And can Patrick Kujala make it four out of four? Don't bet against it the way that he's gone this year. So those in the pit bunkers now can do nothing more than just watch what goes on track. And for the first couple of corners, look for white and red, the livery of Kujala, and the reflective gold painting on the car of Patrick Niederhauser. The second row, Sergio Campana's car is black, and then blue and white, Daniel Zampieri. We are about to go racing. Round four of the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo from Silverstone is go! Who makes the best start on the run down to Copse? It's Kujala, who straight away swoops across the front, and Campana up the inside for second. Patrick Niederhauser caught napping a little bit off the line. He's dropped a place. Wide goes Cozzolino. He's over the curve. Has Niederhauser got a problem? Look, because he's losing another spot. Cozzolino goes up and past him. Patrick Niederhauser, I think, has got a problem because he's just not been able to go with the leader and he's lost places heading up towards the Beckett's S's. He's now got Alberto Di Falco right up with him as well, his teammate. Through Chapel Kerr for the first time onto the hangar straight now, and the race leading car is Patrick Kujala. Is it game over? Let's hope not, but given the way that Kujala has driven this year, he's going to be hard to catch as the rest file their way through. Sergio Campana then in second place going after him. They work their way around the right-hander of Stoke Corner. Alberto Di Falco is trying to gain ground, but what's happened to Niederhauser on that first couple of corners? So much for the effort being made to be on the front of the grid. The car is still dropping down the order by the look of it as they work their way down towards the end of Vale. It could even be a pit visitor at the end of the lap. Has it got a shortage of gears, for example? What is it that's hobbling the pace as they work their way up through Club Corner for the first time? In number 10 there is Adrian Amstutz in the Conrad car, the blue and turquoise and white Conrad livery. Through Abbey for the first time, 15 there. That's Marco Moscato trying to gain ground. And the blue flags being busily waved by the marshals as battles rage on. But Niederhauser, look there, has tumbled down the order. He's now trying to fend off the challenge of Raffaele Giannone, who goes to the outside line, heading up towards the loop and into Aintree. But clearly, all is not well with Niederhauser's car. He made a slow start and just cannot respond. Look how much time he's lost already. And there's just no pace in the car. Onto Wellington straight. He's just easy prey. They're just driving past him. Niederhauser has got big, big problems. And he's going to have to pit, surely, because he's only going to get slower. He's only going to fall further down the order. And the race is effectively run for them already. The leaders come across the timing line. But Patrick comes out of left field. He doesn't pit, strangely. He stays out there. But quite what he's going to achieve, I don't know. Look, he moves to one side, the traffic's going to go past him, and so Niederhauser, as he comes over the line, has got serious problems here. The leader is Kujala, Campana is in second place, third is Zampieri, fourth is Cozzolino, Spengler is fifth, and Di Falco is sixth as they run round Copse Corner for the second time. But Patrick Niederhauser is already 10 seconds back, and he's down in 12th place, and he's tumbling down the order. A car off on the opening lap, incidentally, is that of Cedric Lima. But it's at this area of the circuit, as I understand it. So car 63 off the road, and it was around this section of the circuit. Did Lima rejoin? No, he did not, looking at the timing screen. There it is, Cedric Lima's car with rear damage off the road. And Cedric Lima is one of the more experienced Lamborghini racers. As there, look, there's a challenge being made up on the inside by Pellegrinelli to try to get a place away, coming down towards Vale. But if anything, it's Mikko Eskelinen that's, I think, been able to respond there. It's not Eskelinen at all. It is another of the Bonaldi cars. Eskelinen has dropped back. Pellegrinelli also trying to make some progress as best he can as the field turns its way out of Club Corner. Jürgen Krebs in the mix as well, in the darker green-hued car. Krebs there under attack because he's got 87, which is the car of Stepanov, right up behind him. The leaders work their way out of the loop then through Aintree for the second time. But Patrick Kujala was a second and a half up at the end of the first lap alone. Alberto Di Falco in the what you might now call surviving Raton Racing car, still running strongly within that leading sextet as they come down towards Brooklands. Kai Cozzolino in the red and white car at the head of that trio takes a wider approach into Brooklands, but it doesn't really affect him too much. And Di Falco now all over the back here of Florian Spengler as they work their way up around the right at Luffield. The leader, Kujala, though, is getting away all the while. Over the line comes Spengler, Di Falco right up behind him. Through they go now. Past the pits into the right-hander of Copse Corner, and then they will swoop their way up towards Maggots and Beckett's. Spengler, an experienced driver from GT Racing, goes through Copse way wide. Alberto Di Falco, who was last year's Pro-Am class champion. So Di Falco in number 19, former Formula Renault racer as well, hustling on as he tries to get himself up ahead, but also he's being caught now by Alberto Cecchi, number 6, the silver and green car behind. There, in 96, is Raffaele Giannone, being pursued by Adrian Amstutz in the Conrad car. And there is Niederhauser, who is now 17.3 seconds away from the leaders. He's staying out there, which in a way perplexes me, because if the car has got limited pace, what's he achieving? Can't he pit and try and do something about it? As there look to the inside line, Pellegrinelli makes his move, heading down towards the end of Vale. And Pellegrinelli goes through, up past Niederhauser. So that's for 12th. Pellegrinelli up ahead of Niederhauser. He's down to 13th place. But there doesn't seem to be anything that's going to happen magically to bring Niederhauser's car back into the game. So surely the pit stop is going to be needed. There is Alberto Di Folco, who works his way out of farm now, heading up towards the right-hander into Village. Cars turn up towards the loop and up the inside. Really brave move that by Di Folco from a long way back. Gets past Spengler, runs wide. Spengler comes back at him on the inside. So Spengler, I think, perhaps perceived that with the extra speed Di Folco was going to carry, he could afford to let him go. Up the inside and then out wide goes Alberto Di Folco. So the status quo continues with Spengler ahead. Di Folco down one spot. They're both being caught by Cerqui, who is taking with him Trevisa as well. The top eight all in the pro class now. 44 minutes of the 50 still to run as Patrick Koyala, the leader, has gone through, still with a huge advantage, and it is now 2.6 seconds. Through he goes, Koyala, then Campana second, Zampieri third, fourth is Cozzolino, and then fifth and sixth. This battle between Spengler and again Alberto Di Folco running very, very wide at Copse, and if he carries on doing that, the officials are going to have a long look at it. Niederhauser is pitting. After three laps, Patrick Niederhauser is coming down the pit lane. His teammate here, Alberto Di Folco, carries on. But Patrick Niederhauser's car from the front of the grid down the pit lane. And this is a talking point for sure as to exactly what has happened. So hopefully we'll have news as to why the car has pitted. And more drivers, including the leader, being warned about respecting track limits. Well, there is Patrick Niederhauser, second on the grid, should have been a likely race winner here, and he's in the pit lane. So Koyala on his own up front, 2.6 seconds is his advantage over Campana now. Zampieri runs in third place. And then Kai Cozzolino it is in fourth. But Koyala is one of the drivers, and Di Folco is another, being warned about track limits, transgressed too often, and penalties may start to come. And let's have another look at Alberto Di Folco. We picked up that he was running wide at Copse on more than one occasion. Well, here's more evidence of it. I mean, how wide do you want to be? So he didn't gain a place by that, but certainly he's not slowing his pace, so there's a kind of advantage to be gained. And here, Patrick Niederhauser's car looking ever so sorry for itself, sitting in the pit lane. Remember, it started second on the grid, and there's no real urgency about the work there, suggesting that they know that whatever it is that's gone wrong is terminal and it's game over. The leader, Patrick Koyala, heading up towards the line. His advantage is now 3 seconds over Sergio Campana, but it was Fabrizio Crestani that put in a good stint in that car yesterday as well, the 26th, the second place black car. And also another one that's out of the race, and that's Cedric Lima's car, I think, trudging away. Daniel Zampieri was a retirement yesterday with a mechanical problem. He's third now, the reigning international GT Open champion, with his co-driver Roman Mavlinov, and they're catching Sergio Campana just up the road ahead. Patrick Koyala in the meantime looking well clear in the lead of the race. And there is a very frustrated Patrick Niederhauser. We'll try and grab a word if we can with him, but retirement is clearly what's happened to the car. The mechanical problem can't be cured by a simple reset, so he's out of the race. Good fight here as well, look, because you've got Raffaele Giannone ahead of Adrian Amstutz, who's gone well in the past series, particularly in Dubai. At the end of Vale, Alberto Di Folco trying to find a way past Spengler and also keep Alberto Cerqui at bay. And we understand that the reason that Niederhauser has retired is because of a fuel injector problem. So that's the reason for the demise, sadly, of what should have been a very competitive car. And of course it hit straight away at the start of the race when they went into Copse Corner. So retirement for Patrick Niederhauser. Waved yellow flags here, look up at Village. Now who's had a drama up at this part of the circuit? And are they respecting the yellows? Just about, but there Trevisa was looking for a way past Cerqui. cars turn their way out of Aintree now, heading towards Wellington Straight once more. And as they do so, it is Patrick Koyala who leads the way by 3 seconds. Here is the second place duel, because you've got Campana and Zampieri. But let's try and find out more about Patrick Niederhauser's dramas. He's talking to OJ Borg down at the pit lane.
We can see the mechanics pushing the Lamborghini Huracan away in the background. Patrick, what happened?
Well, I felt already on the green flag lap that what the car was stuttering, and didn't know something with the engine was wrong. We tried to fix it, but we couldn't do it in that short time. We're still analysing what it was. We don't know it exactly.
It's always gutting to retire, but even more so when you've started on the front row.
Yeah, sure. Like, we already had a good second position yesterday. I was fighting for the win at the end. We were really close there. We were really positive today, starting at the front row. You know, everything can happen. So the whole team was really motivated to do it again. And now, it's even more disappointing.
Well, here's the next round. Thank you, Patrick.
Thank you very much.
So that's the answer. Patrick Niederhauser out of the race. Felt the problem on the green flag lap, but nothing could be done in time. So he's a retirement. The sister car of Alberto Di Falco is still running. And the battle for second is starting to take up more attention now, because there's Sergio Campana, who's being caught by Daniel Zampieri, who's right up with him at the end of Vail. 8 minutes and a bit, and then you've got the pit stop window to factor in as well. Meantime, though, the unstoppable force that is Patrick Koyala continues to lead the way. And for somebody that's new to Lamborghini racing, new to GT racing as well this year, he doesn't show it, does he? There is Zampieri, who we've seen go strongly in the Blancpain Endurance Series in a Ferrari. He won the IGTO Championship last year with Ferrari as well. Switches to this new championship for him. New car as well. And out of three races, two non-finishes, but second place here at the inside beckons. He's gone through. Another brave effort pull going into the loop. So problems stopped him there, that corner yesterday. Today is where he gains second place. He runs wide coming onto Wellington Straight over the curb. That might well be another one for the officials to look at. But he's up into second place. Campana is there in third. And the Raton Racing team, they've just lost Niederhauser's car. They're now being summoned to the race director about Alberto Di Falco and track limits. Look at this in replay. Zampieri to the inside, blasts up the inside line and manages to get the car slowed down enough as well to prevent Campana being able to get the switch back going into Aintree. So the line is covered and the place is claimed by up into second place. Now 4.4 seconds back he is before Monza. I was suggesting that Zampieri might well be the man to beat. We haven't seen that pace displayed, but now if the car is good, let's see what he can do to get himself into contention. There's also light rain being reported on the far side of the circuit, and more cars again being warned about track limits. It's just about everybody in the race, I think, is being warned today. Onto Hangar Straight they come. Koyala leading the way comfortably, but Zampieri now in second spot has got 4.4 seconds as his starting point. And in the first sector, he's not as quick, so the gap widens just a little bit there. But let's see whether Koyala now is going to be able to do much with a clear road ahead. There is Kai Cozzolino running in fourth place, and this is his view. The rumble strip on the outside of club, hard on the power, down to Abbey now. Through the right, left at farm. Down through the gears, turn into village, on the power, brake, turn left into the loop. On the power, road opens up a little bit, left again at Aintree, big bite of curb there on the inside. And down Wellington Straight. Cozzolino, though, is under pressure because there's a battle behind where you've got Spengler, Di Falco and Cerqui. Florian Spengler staying at the head of it at three, not that far behind Cozzolino. He needs to be careful about them. And in fact, behind Cerqui, there's Travazza. So there's four in a line here for fifth place. Over the timing line they come. There, number four, is Gerhard Travazza. He's just been warned about the track limits. Yesterday, Travazza turned around the car ahead, the silver and green one that pops out of the draft there. It was driven at the time by Giacomo Barri. Now it's being driven by Alberto Cerqui. But because of the incident, Travazza copped a drive-through. He's got a new co-driver as well this weekend, Azaf Tutumlu, through the Beckett's S's. They sweep for this, the eighth time of asking. Lots of people being warned. The only team with a representative having to see the race director is Raton, that runs Alberto Di Folco. So there could be some more to that story still to come. Through the right-hander of Stowe Corner goes Florian Spengler. He's keeping at bay Alberto Di Folco, who in turn is going to try and fend off the challenge of Alberto Cecchi, the former Superstars racer. And look how late there. Di Folco breaks at the end of Vale right onto the back of Spengler, and he brings Cecchi with him. Travazza possibly here, just holding a watching brief, waiting to see what pans out ahead of him. Way wide at club, though, goes Cherqui that time, so that'll be another one, I think, that the officials will want to investigate as the cars now go through the right left at Abbey and Farm. Very fast S, really, that has become these days. And then on the power, down to Village, so they hit the brakes, the nose drops, there you could see on Di Folco's car, and he's close to Spengler once more. They work their way up towards the loop, round the left-hander, and then back on the power into Aintree. Sprinting their way down towards Brooklands. Di Folco half pops out of the draft to have a look and then gets back in again. He's not actually close enough there to make a move. And so Florian Spengler, under pressure, hangs onto his fifth place as they work their way up towards the right-hander there at Luffield. Number four, Gerhard Trevazza. As I say, he's an experienced Lamborghini racer, whether it's been in this championship or in GT racing. He pounds on, works his way through the right-hander at Woodcut, over the timing line they go. Now down towards Copse once again. Kujala's advantage over Zampieri is coming down a little bit because it's down to 3.4 seconds. We're watching fifth, where still Spengler keeps Di Folco at bay. But just up the road a little bit more, the lead gap is coming down ever so slightly. Zampieri pushing on as best he can for the Antonelli Motorsport team. There's Travazza at the back of the group for 5th, 6th, 7th and 8th places. At the head of this train is Cozzolino. You can see that he's not really that far ahead. And Di Folco now perhaps is close enough to think about making a move as they work their way down towards Stowe Corner. Is this going to be an opportunity? Not there, it's not. Through the corner they come now. This is the run down towards Brooklands. And a replay of a spin here for Karina Lima, who ran very, very wide towards the curb on the outside of Aintree and then kind of tried to correct what was happening and just lost the back of the car. So that's one of the Gallardos, one of the older cars in the race. And spinning, able to rejoin us there. Through the traffic comes Zampieri. That's Tim Richards. He's just lapped the Canadian, battling with the red car behind of Nima Kandamnia. Zampieri in second spot then in the first sector of this lap. He was fractionally slower. And another team being summoned to the race director is that of Alberto Cecchi. I think we just identified club corner. So Cecchi then for the Imperiale racing team. He also has been reported to the race director. And so the team managers are starting to be a bit busier. And now at turn eight, we are being told, there is some rain falling. And turn eight is Stowe. It's on the very, very far side of the circuit. In fact, in a different county, because Stowe's in Buckinghamshire, the rest of Silverstone's in Northamptonshire, there is some rain falling. So just very isolated at the moment. The team's being warned about it on the screens. Florian Spengler hangs onto his place as he comes up over the timing line. Cozzolino in 16 hangs onto that fourth place, but this train of cars behind is intriguing. They've all bunched up again. Di Folco has taken Cecchi with him. They're right on the tail of Spengler, but they can't yet really find a way to get past Spengler. The German driver is doing a good job of hanging onto that place. Now the pit window will be open at the end of this lap, 54 seconds, and it'll be open. So if they wish, they can stop this time. If you have your slower driver in first, you want to get him out of the car and put your gun in. And 87 is an example of that, where you've got Mikhail Stepanov and Harold Schlegelmilch. Schlegelmilch is the quicker, but that car's down in 18th place, and it's going to be one that will pit early, I think, because through the traffic there goes Florian Spengler. Alberto Di Folco tucked up behind him. Is he going to be able to make a move down through Vale? The traffic's possibly going to go against him here. There is Tim Richards. Does force the issue, and he does go through. Really good stuff. Very opportunistic, that. He saw half a gap, but he runs wide at club, and back on the inside comes Spengler, and Spengler retakes the place, but he runs wide, and he's sideways. It goes left, it goes right. He's going to go round. Spengler spins, and thankfully everybody misses him, but that could have been very nasty indeed. Florian Spengler gets it going once more, but that was just two lead and a right foot coming out of club corner, and he ran wide and it just got away from him. So Alberto Cerqui gains a place as a result of that, because as DeFalco gets past Spengler, so Cerqui and Travazza able to inherit. The pit window is open, and Gerhard Travazza sitting right on the tail here of Alberto DeFalco as they work their way down towards the left-hander at Brooklands. It just had the first pit visitor, I think I'm right in saying, which was Davide Doranti, to come in. There is Doranti down the pit road. And on track here, the fight continues between Cerqui and Tverazza. DeFalco through. Do we have any of the leaders pitting? No, not yet. So the order is Cuyala, Zampieri from in third spot now. Sergio Campana, fourth is Cosolino, fifth is DeFalco, and sixth is Cerqui. Seventh is Travazza, and Spengler, eighth after his spin. He stayed out there, has he? No, he's come in this time, in fact. So Spengler pits at the end of lap 10. Also, I think coming in behind is Raffaele Giannoni. So the order starts to shuffle as more and more head down the pit lane, but on track, still Cerqui fends off Tverazza. There for the Antonelli team, in has come 15, which is Marco Moscato, and he will give way to Loris Spinelli, AutoGP drivers both. Nima Candania gives way to Jake Rattenbury. There, Gallardo into the pit lane, and there are more coming in as well. So it's a pretty brief window, this, just 10 minutes, which is about five laps maximum around Silverstone. Moscato out, Spinelli in to 15. Here's the leader. Seldom has he been described as anything other in the championship this year, because Patrick Cuyala has just been so, so dominant. It'll be interesting to see if and when anybody can topple him. But Cuyala, who, with respect, never looked like a real find in GP3, has done a very, very good job in these cars. But you see how wide he runs there, all four wheels behind the white line. The track limits issue, still a thorny one. Down towards Brooklands he comes now. Through the left-hander, is he going to pit this time? The gap between him and Zampieri had come down to 2.5 seconds. But I still think that Roman Mavlinov will lose time relative to Cuyala. Cuyala quicker than the Russian driver. Through goes the leader then. The Finn is ahead of the Italian, Daniel Zampieri, who you see in the background now. And that gap has just come down by 0.4 seconds. It's down to 2.1 now. Zampieri perhaps aware that this is his last hurrah before he has to give the car over. He's throwing everything at it in third place, and really having dropped back a long way now is Campana. He will give way to Fabrizio Crestani. There in fourth is Alberto DeFalco. Fifth is Cerqui there, and sixth in the white car is Tverazza. Heading down the pit lane is Kai Cosolino to give way to Junior Michimi. Board says you want to be stopping here, and he knows where the team is. The car stops on its marks. Out will get Cosolino, in will get Junior Michimi, and the pit stop will be cycled through as on track. Still pounding on as best he can. Lower down the order is Neil Huggins in the Gallardo category. But Neil, new to the championship this weekend. He's an experienced club racer in the UK, but not having raced really at this level around these people before as well. Top Cats, Warren Gilbert's team. Another good British club racing squad as well. Right, so Michimi is in. Cosolino closes the door. And 16, which is one of the Vincenzo Sospiri racing cars, will be good to go. That black bodywork on the left front is a legacy of an incident with Tim Richards yesterday. 96, in the meantime, is Raffaele Giannoni. And Cuyala is the race leader. Has 16 got to the end of his allotted time in the pits yet? Ready to go. Cuyala comes out of Aintree. Again, very, very wide there, all over the kerb. Down Wellington Straight, the gap between the two leaders was up a little bit in the first sector, but down by 0.7 in the second sector. So really pushing hard is Zampieri, but Mavlinov won't be able to match the pace of Cuyala, I'm afraid. So it's going to come to nothing, but it's been a very, very valiant effort, that's for sure, by Zampieri as they work their way now up towards the timing line again, and they both stay out for another lap. So the gap this time is 1.7 seconds between the two of them. Into the right-hander of Kopp's corner they go now. There is number two, Mikko Eskelinen, the Finnish driver. Eskelinen's car, has it made a stop back? So it's now Calvin Snooks behind the wheel. I was looking to see why it had dropped down to 21st. A pit stop is the answer. So he is now the Dutchman Calvin Snooks, former single-seater racer, looking to gain ground back again. Into the pits has come Gerhard Verhaeser to give way to Isaac Tuomela, another experienced driver, but not in Lamborghinis, having his first outing in the championship this weekend. Tuomela in. Tire pressure's checked and adjusted if needs be. Tim Richards' blue car keeping out of the way as, again, in replay here, you see how DeFalco made his move earlier. And this is what happened to Spengler, because he gets up the inside, thinks fantastic, got the gap there, got the inside line, but just lost the back and it snaked left and right and eventually round it looped. That's what gave DeFalco the place. No action, as far as we can tell, taken against any of those teams that were summoned to see the race director. So just a bit of a talking to, I think, has been the go. There is Patrick Kujala, who I suspect will be in this time. But look how close Zampieri is, and look again how wide Kujala runs, way wide over the curb, coming out of Aintree. He's pushing his luck a little bit with that, I would have thought. Lap after lap after lap. Comes down into Brooklands, and the traffic getting in the way a little bit there, look. Is that Pellegrinelli's car? I think it is. So Simone Pellegrinelli, not deliberately, but just getting in the way. And so the lead gap has come right down, but the leader is in. In comes the top two, because not only into the pit lane comes Patrick Kujala, but Zampieri comes in as well. So it's going to be Patrick Kujala to stay in the car, but Daniel Zampieri to give way to Roman Mavlinov. Drivers waiting for their cars. The VSR on the overalls is Vincenzo Sospiri Racing, and drivers await their cars, await their turn behind the wheel. There is, for the Bernardi team, the car of Patrick Kujala, serving its pit stop. They're all done to a time. They're not what you might call a natural pit stop, in other words, a quick-as-you-can pit stop. They are designed to equate between the single and the two-driver entries, and so you are stationary for a minute and then allowed back into the race. That's another reason why it looks early on in the pit window as though people have lost a huge amount of time, because they do lose a minute to the opposition, but then they gain that minute back again as the other cars serve their stops. So Kujala waits for the end of the time, and off he goes down the pit lane. Bernardi Motorsport, one of the best teams in the championship, so they will have the pit stops well drilled. Others venture back out into the race as well, with now 22 minutes, give or take, still to go. There is Roman Mavlinov then, who's taken over from Daniel Zampieri. And he's overtaken, leaving the pit lane, because he was a bit sluggish there. I think that was acceptable, but was that Kujala getting ahead of him? Let's just have a look as they come up towards Maggots. I think that Kujala was on his toes rather better than Mavlinov was, and so he's actually taken the lead, leaving the pit lane. Yes, he has. So Kujala it was who, for whatever reason, had actually fallen behind a little bit on that pit stop. Whether it was a slow release or whether it was a short pit stop from Mavlinov, we'll have to find out. But anyway, Kujala nips ahead of him on the exit of the pit lane. Here we go. Mavlinov is ahead. There is Kujala, so he's fallen behind him on the pit stop and just blasts past him just over the white line. We've got some spots of rain falling now. Just thinking back to Patrick Kujala's overtaking the pits, had he been slow away to err on the side of caution to make sure that the pit stop time was absolutely correct, in which case, why was Mavlinov ahead of him? Because it should have been that they left in the same order. In other words, Kujala ahead and Mavlinov behind. That's how Zampieri had brought the car in. So maybe Mavlinov's stop was a little bit short, or maybe Kujala's stop was a little bit long, but either way, he's redressed the balance by blasting past at the end of the pit lane. Now, at Woodcote, there are spots of rain falling. We have a warning flag for number 33 Florian Spengler about track limits, and wet tyres look being made ready. 18 in the pit lane is the car of Jacopo Faccioni to give way to the Australian driver Oliver Ray, but I wouldn't have thought it was wet enough yet to think about wet tyres. It's only spots of rain that we have, but the wipers are on at other parts of the circuit. It's been one of those days where rain has come briefly but irritatingly, and a car has been caught out at Loughfield. Incidentally, there's one car that spun out on track, so certainly the rain is having a bit of an impact now. There may not be much of it falling, but if you're on slick tyres and suddenly the grip level changes, it's going to have an impact. Here is 78. Now this is the car up into seventh place now of Shota Abkhazava, the Artline Team Georgia car going strongly, the Pro-Am class headed by Adrian Amstutz from Oliver Ray, then Spinelli, Giannone, Pellegrinelli and Eskilinen, or now Snooks indeed, who's taken over that car. But the Am category is where Abkhazava races. There he comes down towards Brooklands. Ahead of Abkhazava has been another incident, and there's a car off at Brooklands because there's lots of dust settling. There's a car in the gravel bed, so the rain on this section of the circuit through the stadium is catching them out. Abkhazava leads the Ams. There is a Bernaldi car in the gravel bed by the look of it, but which one? Hidden from view, and it's got a long way off. In fact, to get to the tyres though, it's gone across tarmac and gravel, and wet tyres now being put onto 15 there, look, which is the car now in the hands of Loris Spinelli. Others rather hoping that it dries out, but we've got cars spinning off the road all the while over in the stadium. There is a stop-go penalty of 1 second for number 69, which is Jake Rattenbury. We've got a spin for Mikhail Spiridonov, over in the stadium, but Spiridonov is going to hopefully get going. And the one in the gravel that we saw is Matteo Bobby. So Matteo Bobby, former FIA GT champion, has gone off the road at Brooklands and gone into the wall. So all of a sudden, the race turned upside down. We've now got, after pit stops as well, this car running in third place overall, Adrian Amstutz. But with the pit window closed, the next lap round, we're going to get the true race order once more. So it's going to have Patrick Kujala back into the lead of the race and pretty much on his own. Look how wide there Amstutz goes, coming out of Aintree. Mavrinov is in second place, 7.3 seconds back, and then another 3 seconds back is Alberto Di Folco. Into the pits has come Tim Richards. You might anticipate that the Ams will be a bit more cautious and want to go on to wet tyres, but the rain is still falling. The spots of rain are still hitting the windows of the commentary booth, and so if it gets much worse, are they going to be able to survive on wet tyres, or will they need on slick rather, or will they need to pit for wet? The wipers are on for the majority of cars. They are of course on Pirelli tyres that are warm, but not warm enough to save there, going off the road in number 10 Adrian Amstutz at Copse Corner. That's why that tarmac is there, so if you have a mistake, you can sort yourself out, not to use it to your advantage. But with the road getting ever more treacherous, perhaps this is where a Scandinavian is going to be very, very good indeed. Patrick Kujala having to take to the curb there to avoid the back marker, but Kujala for Bonaldi leads the way. 16 minutes to go, working his way now up towards Abbey. This part of the circuit looks pretty good, doesn't it? This looks dry. It's more towards the end of the lap where conditions have turned a bit nasty. So into Village then comes Patrick Kujala. Up to the loop, through the left. Try in these conditions, of course, to keep away in part from those painted wet curbs, but Kujala still rides over them coming out of Aintree, but with them being painted and slippery, they can spit you off the road, a bit like we saw with Spengler early on. So Kujala to Mavrinov was 7.3 seconds, and in fact, in the first sector it widened a lot. In the second sector it came down by a couple of tenths, but I think still Kujala is on target for 4 from 4 here. He's looked so good all season. Can't really think of a way that the opposition are going to stop him in this race, unless he makes a mistake on the changing conditions that we have on the track. Over the line he goes, still 15 run. Now what's going on behind him? Because Mavrinov is a long way back now, and comes there into shot with the blue stripe over the top of the car. In third place behind him should be Alberto Di Folco, and Di Folco's car is that one, the gold car, just ahead of the black one in the hands of now Fabrizio Crestani. So the traffic has got in the way just a little bit, and that in turn has split up the groups. But the leader has a 9.4 second advantage now on what is considered by the race director a wet track. That message is on the screen for the teams to communicate with the drivers, who will probably be getting the message anyway as they turn into a corner and find the grip isn't what they anticipated. In the traffic there, 44 Neil Huggins about to be passed by a charging Fabrizio Crestani. And down towards Stowe Corner, Roman Mavlinov works his way past a back marker. Mavlinov in second place, but still dropping away, of course, from Patrick Kujala. Mavlinov is quick, but nobody, it seems, is as quick as Kujala this year in Lamborghini racing. Alberto Folco is now, this is the man in third place, being given a 1 second stop and go penalty. Di Folco gets a 1 second stop go, that's presumably for a pit infringement, and the team's there ready to receive him. So a 1 second stop go penalty for Alberto Di Folco. Was in third place then, so, or is in third place now, but that's going to disappear when he has to serve that penalty. This is where the teams have to be good on the pit stops. It's not about doing the work quickly, it's about adhering to the time and releasing the driver at the right time so that the cumulative pit stop time, including the actual stop and the drive in and drive out time, is absolutely on the money. And that's again perhaps why Kujala was erring on the side of caution and just being a little bit slower as he went down the pit lane, which in turn gave briefly Mavlinov the lead. Now there, coming down towards Brooklands, is 26, the fourth place car of Fabrizio Crestani. He's about to become third because Di Folco ahead of him will cop this 1 second stop and go penalty. In he comes, and Di Folco down the pit lane. That white line where the speed limit board is where he's got to hit the brakes. And where is the stop-go penalty box for him? There it is. And he goes straight past. So he's not gone to the stop-and-go, is he? There's a car in the gravel, Neil Huggins, 44 off the road. But Di Folco, if he hasn't served it at the stop-go penalty box, he's going to have to come back in. Neil Huggins in the gravel, out of the race. That, I think, is a cops looking at it. And so we will have a yellow flag in that zone, 12 minutes still to run. So again, although the road doesn't look that wet, people are being caught out. Again, it's this being tricked into it, I think, that they think is a bit drier than it is. Here's what happened to Neil Huggins. He just loses the back, turning into the corner. Round he goes, and the gravel does its job. It arrests the car, but the trouble is he can't drive out of there, seemingly. So Neil Huggins is a retirement. 12 minutes of the race to go. Now, what happened to Di Folco? Because although he has pitted, I'm not entirely sure. He did it the right way by going past the officials. He went to the team, but his stop-go penalty message has now gone off the screen, as though the race director is content that he served it with the team rather than just with the officials. Anyway, we'll see whether he gets called back in. Meantime, at Stowe here, there's a good little fight for ninth place between the silver and blue car in the hands of Simone Pellegrinelli and Raffaele Giannoni. This is for second in the Pro-Am class. Adrian Amstutz is the class leader, but Pellegrinelli and Giannoni running nose to tail as they work their way out of club with just over 11 minutes still on the clock. Through they come. Now, this is the right-hander that takes you through Abbey, and Giannoni has inched his way into contention. Pellegrinelli kind of on the back foot of it coming here this weekend in terms of car knowledge, because think back to Monza, lap one, race one, he went off into the barriers and did a huge amount of damage to his car and couldn't race for the rest of the weekend. So he's a virtual rookie compared to others who did a lot more track time at Monza than he was able to get in. Raffaele Giannoni turns through Aintree. Lower down the order, how is here Shota Abkhazava doing? He is leading his class still in 13th place. He's the leading Am. The leading Gallardo, incidentally, is that of Anders Josefsson and Ricardo Vera. And just coming down the pit lane is 15, which is Loris Spinelli. Now, he went on to wet, didn't he? And has just come back in. So I think he feels it's still slicks weather. If you're careful on slicks, it's better than being on wet tyres, because the rain has not come with the intensity they needed it to. Thirteen there is Jürgen Krebs, new to the championship this year, but Jürgen yesterday was one of the drivers responsible for getting in the way rather of the overall race leader, namely Patrick Kujala, and the former Swiss Porsche Cup racer, second at the moment in the AM class, was not very well thought of at the end by the race winner. But he comes now out of the loop. There is DeFalco back on track behind Spengler, with whom he was battling earlier in the race. So Alberto DeFalco slips to seventh place after that moment that necessitated him to come and serve the stop-go, in other words, by the pit stop being too short. This is club corner through the right. Power on. And now the field looking at the race with just over 9 minutes still to go. Nose to tail, they run up through Farm, heading now towards the right-hander at Village. Two of them still tied together pretty much. They've got a back marker to get past as well. Tim Richards in the blue car. In fairness to him, he keeps well out of the way. Is DeFalco going to be able to run up the inside? He thinks about it, but the door is closed. Oh, contact still comes, though, because DeFalco tried to make the move on the inside. He thought there was a gap, but wasn't quite, so they nudge each other, and it remains Spengler who stays ahead there. DeFalco right on his tail. DeFalco well fired up after having to serve the stop-go penalty. He goes to the outside line as they come down to Brooklands. On the inside line there, the white car in the hands of Florian Spengler, the German, keeping him at bay. Up to Brooklands they go now, through the right. This is a corner that loops them back round towards Woodcote, and now it is on the power. Change up, 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 through Woodcote, up, over the timing line, up another gear, down towards Copse, fast right. Can DeFalco make a move there? Let's see, pit boards go out for some of the teams. DeFalco pulls out, has a look, and then pulls back in again. Can't make the move there as they work their way around Copse. Both run wide over the curbs, though, and now head up towards the left-hander, through Maggots now. There's more traffic ahead as well, and that's not going to help the situation here. Florian Spengler up the inside does now go through, sorts out the slower car, but he's going to have DeFalco even closer behind him as they make the run now along the hangar straight. In fact, nice and early. DeFalco tries to commit to a move on the outside, but it's the wrong line, really. Once more, Florian Spengler is able to fend him off. The Pro-Am class leader, eighth, incidentally, just behind them, is Adrian Amstutz, and he's just been warned about the track limits issue once more. Down to the end of Vale. In traffic comes the fight for sixth place. Florian Spengler having to go around the outside of the traffic, and right on his tail, look, there is the gold Raton racing car in the hands of Alberto DeFalco. They make the run now up along the fast straight towards Abbey. Flip right, then left at Farm. 7 more minutes to go. DeFalco looks like he's quick enough to get past, but he just not yet found the opportunity, and it won't come at Village, I don't think, either. Another little tap in the tail as DeFalco tries to find a way through, but he just cannot rattle Florian Spengler here. Onto Wellington straight they go. They both run wide in the Gallardo class, incidentally. It's still the Andreas Josefsson, Ricardo Vera car leading. But DeFalco here tries to commit to the inside line, can't do it. Working their way once again up towards Luffield. Still absolutely nose to tail. And the more Spengler has to defend, so the more he drops back from the leading quintet ahead of him, but DeFalco just can't find a way through. He's certainly quicker, but a really good defensive drive this by Florian Spengler. Look, he covers the inside line nice and early, down towards Copse corner. 3 more laps as right round the outside goes DeFalco. He's done it, he's taken the place, but he runs out wide, keeps his foot in and hangs on to it. So Alberto DeFalco goes through. Used a bit of the track limits issue, didn't he? But anyway, he's gone by into the Beckett's S's. Alberto DeFalco through, right round the outside, then takes the place away from Florian Spengler. And now DeFalco into the top six. Is there any chance that he can do much about Isaac Tutumlu, who's the next man up the road? Look in the white car. He's only got to make up 2 seconds or so. Tutumlu took over from Trevaza, and he doesn't know the car as well as DeFalco does. He's new to the championship. So DeFalco turns his way around Stowe. There's the car in second place still, Roman Mavlinov. Mavlinov working his way up towards Village now. Five more minutes on the clock. Others being warned about track limits include Roman Mavlinov running in second place, and also now Andrea Palmer, who's taken over from Corina Lima in one of the Gallardos. He's being warned about the track limits as well. Patrick Cuyala, though, continues to hold sway up front. He leads the race. He turns through Luffield. And there, out of the gravel, but into the pit lane, Neil Huggins. He was off at Cops Corner, remember? Comes into the pit lane. The team will check the car over, and if they can send him back, then they will. The lead gap extending 8.7 seconds. Remember that when they got to pit out, it was the other way round. So Cuyala has had to work hard in terms of pulling away. Nipping past at the end of the pit lane wasn't quite so difficult, as long as it was legal. But it shows you the differing pace between Zampieri, who brought the car right onto Cuyala's tail, and Roman Mavlinov here, who is not able to match those lap times. Onto Hangar Straight he goes, the run down towards Stowe Corner here. That wet mid part of the race, catching out quite a few people, shuffling the order. But Patrick Cuyala, the Finn, coping with the conditions. There is Roman Mavlinov, the Russian driver, still hanging on to his second place as he comes out of Stowe. Heads to the end of Vale now, but he should be okay to hang on, or should he, to second place, because have a look back behind. The black car of Fabrizio Crestani is getting a little bit nearer. Thought he was a bit more comfortable than this, but actually the gap is starting to come down a little bit. So he's not quite as safe here, Roman Mavlinov. There is Fabrizio Crestani, and he could well be now the man to watch before the end of the race. There's probably only time for two more laps. But that gap could come down enough to enable Crestani to have a go before the very end here. Cuyala leading. Second is Mavlinov. Spots of rain on the camera lens over at Aintree, where it's bone dry again at Woodcote. Through goes Crestani, uses the curves on the outside of the road. Crestani, who is another driver who has come into the championship new this year, but an experienced single-seater racer, driven in the international Formula. Oh, drama there. We've got Di Folco off the road. And Tutumlu. That was about to be the battle for fifth place. And the two of them up the escape road at Village. And Di Folco's car with damage. Is he going to be able to carry on in the race? Let's see. I don't think he wants to turn, does it? The suspension is damaged on that front right corner. Big bite of bodywork as well. Alberto Di Folco's Raton Racing car is out of the race. What a miserable race for Raton Racing. They lost Niederhauser and Liberati's car early on, and then Di Folco off the road as well. There's another slow car just creeping through. That's the Cerqui Giacomo Balli car, I think, that's a couple of laps down and was in that leading group early on as well. That's had strife. So it's all starting to shuffle around once again as the field works its way there through Brooklands. 99 is Mikhail Spiridonov after his spin early on in the race. We're into the last 2 minutes, but that clash between Di Folco and Tutumlu certainly has put Di Folco out of the race. And this is what happened. Well, we kind of see the aftermath as they've made contact coming into shot, but I suspect it was Di Folco making a rather brave move there that just did not pay off. Tagged the car of Tutumlu, put them both off. And you can see the damage there on the front corner of Alberto Di Folco's car. I just wonder, though, as well, whether that part of the circuit's got wet again. You've seen the spots on the camera lens. So if the road is wet and Di Folco committed and then lost traction, it would account for why he slithered into the car of Tutumlu. Patrick Cuyala is going to get one more lap out of the race, though, as he works his way now down towards Brooklands once more. And with Alberto Di Folco out of the race, that puts into the top six now. Adrian Amstutz ahead of Pellegrinelli, and then Kelvin Snoeks in Mikko Eskelinen's car into eighth place. Good job, that, by the Dutch driver. Koyala's advantage, 8.5 seconds. He turns his way now around Luffield. He's heading up towards the timing line. And so Patrick Cuyala set, seemingly, for a win as he sprints his way up towards the line. But with half a minute to go, he's going to get one more lap out of the race. Through he goes now, then. Barring a disaster, it is Cuyala's race for the taking there. He turns his way through Copse. There is Tim Richards, a lap down. For second and third, is it going to change? It's 1 second, starting the last lap here between Mavlinov and then Crestani. There, turning through in number 22, is the car of the Montez brothers, Eugenio and Sergio. Eugenio at the wheel at the moment. So Roman Mavlinov is going to try and fend off here the challenge of Fabrizio Crestani for another lap. Bit under now, but they get past Tim Richards okay. There is the black car of Crestani. The gap is coming down and down and down. Is there enough time left in the race? Crestani is inching up onto the back, but he's not carving his way onto the tail of Mavlinov. That said, the fact that he's almost now within striking distance will certainly inspire him even more. They get to the end of the hangar straight, they turn into the right-hander now, and then it's down through Vail. Into club corner for the last time. Crestani close, but he's not going to get close enough to make a move unless Mavlinov makes a mistake, and that is feasible, it could happen. The cars power their way then up past the wing on the right-hand side, the new Silverstone building into Abbey they come now. Koyala is 9.7 seconds up the road, set fair for a win. But the cars turn their way now into the right-hander at Village. You can see how committed Crestani is to this, you can see how much closer he's got, but it's just not close enough, is it? Through the corner they come now, onto Wellington Straight for the last time, and Mavlinov looks as though he's got just enough in hand. Down they come, they're turning through the right-hander at Luffield. 32 is Patrick Koyala. He will sprint his way up now towards the timing line, and this amazing run continues 100%. It's 4 from 4 from Patrick Koyala, who comes across the line to take yet another victory. For second, absolutely nose to tail though, Roman Mavlinov caught at the end by Fabrizio Crestani. Mavlinov hangs on to his second place, Crestani takes third, and in the end they were 10 seconds away from the dominant Koyala, the race winner. Mavlinov then with Zampieri second, third going the way of Crestani and to Sergio Campana, who did the first stint. Fourth over the line is Cinio Machimi and Francesco Cosolino ahead of Florian Spengler. It should be for fifth place. Coming out of Woodcut then up towards the timing line, and sixth will go the way of the Pro-Am winner, which is number 10, Adrian Amstutz. Comes across the line, Adrian Amstutz wins his class in fine style as he comes through ahead of Kelvin Snooks and Mikko Eskelinen. And then for third in the class it will be 87, which is Harold Schlegelmilk and Mikhail Stepanov, up from a lowly grid position, so a good effort done there. And what about the AMs? Shota Abkazava is going to be the winning AM ahead of Mark Inaiken, who's already home, and then third will be the Montez, Eugenio and Sergio. Here's Shota Abkazava then, set for a class win. Works his way up towards the right-hander of Luffield. He'll turn his way through in a moment then, up towards the timing line, and Shota Abkazava set for honours at Silverstone. Checkered flag is at the ready. He's going to take 11th place overall. He will be the last unlapped driver as well. Shota Abkazava comes across the line to win the AM class ahead of Inaiken and the Montez, with then the Gallardo class being won by Anders Josefsson and Ricardo Vera from the car in the hands of Cyril Lima. And third in the class will be Nima Kandanir and Jake Rattenbury, despite a stop-go penalty. So Patrick Koyala celebrates his victory here. And there, a punctured tyre, I fear, on his slowing down lap for Pellegrinelli. Puffs of smoke and the car looking low. Either it's a puncture or something's broken, and suddenly the car drops on that front left corner. You could hear the splitter dragging on the ground. Not sure necessarily it's a punctured tyre. And that's the class-winning Amstutz who stopped. That fuel, is out of fuel, potentially? Can't imagine it would be, given that the pace of the race was a bit slower because of the rain. Anyway, Pellegrinelli has got problems, that's for sure. And that car, limping back to the pit lane. Not a very slow limp, I would suggest. The fact that he's overtaking people, despite the damage, is not necessarily the most inspired idea here. I just back it right off and go slowly and preserve what there is. But the car's head for Parc Fermé. driver is Mark Inaiken, who is the second of the AMs. 22, Eugenio and Sergio Montes, third of the AMs. And being shoehorned into a gap, which is a bit pointless because now nobody can get out of a car, was Roman Bavlanov. But how now Eugenio Montes is about to extricate himself from his car, I'm not entirely sure. He can't open his door, so going to have to somehow clamber out of that. It might have been an idea to have let him out before they put a car in the middle. Anyway, Roman Bavlanov gets out. And second place, his best of the year. They've had a couple of races with mechanical issues this season. And there is a very big issue, and that's the damage to Alberto Di Folco's car after the clash with Tutumlu a few laps ago. So happy scenes underneath the podium as the drivers in a few moments will, for the four podium ceremonies that we have, head up there. There's one for the pros, the pro-ams, the ams, and then the amateur Gallardo class as well. So it's all part of this sort of family atmosphere that the championship engenders, that there's something for everybody to aim for. Patrick Cuyala, though, it's just an amazing effort, this. Last year we kind of discovered Jerome Mull, who came good at Silverstone, didn't go so well at Monza, but got better and better. But Cuyala has just been on the money right from the word go, and seemingly this is the car that's absolutely ideal for him. So photos to be taken. He's not even got his helmet off yet, but the celebrations have begun, and the Bernaldi Motorsport team very pleased, I think, to have got the young Finn on its books for this year. We'll try and have a word with Patrick in a moment once he's got his crash helmet off. OJ is there poised, ready to have a word with Mr. 100%, 4 out of 4 for Patrick, the flying Finn. And Patrick Cuyala takes off his crash helmet as a race winner. Patrick Cuyala takes a fourth win of the season here at Silverstone.
There's handshakes as the helmet comes off. Congratulations, Patrick, another dominating win.
Yes,
thank you.
Amazing job by the team. Great car today also. Everything worked as we planned. Maybe those little raindrops, I was maybe backing up a bit too much. Then I thought the track is not wet at all, so keep on pushing. Saving tires, saving brakes, saving everything. So comfortable win at the end.
It was a comfortable win. Just talk us through what happened in the pit lane.
There's someone backed up a bit too much. Maybe they left him go too early and he needed to brake too much, so I'm not going to stay behind him, so I overtook him.
So we go round to the next round of this Super Trofeo. Another two wins you must be looking for.
I hope so. Fingers crossed we can do it.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And so Patrick Cuyala starts the celebrations. Four races, four victories. And don't forget, this is a completely new discipline to him for this year, racing in a GT car. So Silverstone's second race that gives us a win for Patrick Cuyala, ahead of Daniel Zampieri and then Roman Bavlanov. Third, Sergio Campana and Fabrizio Crestani, ahead of Shinya Michimi and Kai Cozzolino. Florian Spengler fifth, and sixth in the pro class, Gerhard Travazza and Isaac Tutumlu. Despite the damage, Di Folco retirement, we lost also Cerqui and Barry, and Liberati and Niederhauser barely got into the race before they had the fuel injector problem that stopped them right at the very beginning. Pro-Am, a win for Adrian Amstutz ahead of Mikael Eskelinen and Kelvin Snooks. Mikhail Stepanov third, sharing with Harold Schlegelmilch, ahead of Raffaele Giannone. Simone Pellegrinelli off the podium today and ahead of the troubled Smidelli and Moscato, who had to make that extra pit stop to go back from wet onto slick tyres. They gambled and it was the wrong choice. Olli Rehn and Jacopo Faccioni seventh, with Palmer and Bobby out of the race. And the AMs, Shota Abkozava the winner, ahead of Mark Inaiken, and then Eugenio and Sergio Montes third, ahead of Jürgen Krebs, Mikhail Spidorinov, with newcomers this year Roberto Pampanini and Christoph Lenz taking fifth in the class. So the drivers, and there are many of them, being assembled at the back of the podium, ready for the first of the podium ceremonies. As I say, there is Pro, Pro-Am, Am, and then the Gallardo class as well, so four in all. And as soon as everybody is where they should be, we might be good to go.
Okay, so let's have the podium starting then for the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo, the overall results.
The overall drivers, the top three as well in the Pro category, will make their way out onto the podium, with Sergio Campana and Fabrizio Crestani being the first drivers onto the podium for third in class. For second, it will be Daniel Zampieri and Roman Mavlanov. But the top step, and he has an account seemingly for the top step, he's been there in every race this season, is the Finn Patrick Kujala. The Bonaldi Motorsport driver makes his way out onto the podium and gets a great reception from his team. He stands on the top step of the podium. Bonaldi Motorsport is the winning team as well, and it'll be the national anthem of the winning team here at Silverstone. So Patrick Kujala on the top step of the podium. The normal protocol is that it's the team anthem, but it's the driver anthem that has been played. So you heard the Finnish anthem for Kujala. And the trophy is now being presented there to the third place drivers of Crestani and Campana. For second spot, Roman Mavlanov and Daniel Zampieri. Rather frustrated, I think, with the fact that Kujala is just too good at the moment. And the Bonaldi driver gets yet another of these excellent golden trophies. Dedicates the win to the team. And there is also a Blancpain clock as well that goes to the winner. Patrick Kujala is getting quite a collection of these as well. That one possibly might go to the team. They're worth a lot of money as well, of course, Blancpain timepieces. And then Pirelli hand over a winner's trophy as well. There's some champagne somewhere knocking about as well, which will go the way of the winner. But first of all, there are photographs to be taken of all the drivers together on the top step, the sort of group photograph, the family shot of everybody at the end of this fourth round of the championship. The next stop is Paul Ricard in the third week of June, and then it goes to Spa, then the Nürburgring, and the European Series finishes at the world final event at Sebring this year in November, as the champagne is sprayed once more by Patrick Kujala as a race winner. There is seemingly just no stopping him at the moment. So the Pro drivers will make their way from the podium. Of course, they've rounded up all the trophies and the hats, and I think Patrick Kujala is going to have a word to the fans at the circuit as well over the PA about yet another good win. Then we'll turn our attention to the Pro-Am podium, the top step of which will be claimed by Adrian Amstutz. And the drivers there behind the podium being made ready. The trophies will be brought out, the champagne will be put into place. And then as soon as everybody is good to go, then out will come the class-winning Adrian Amstutz, also Mikko Askelinen and Kelvin Snooks, and Mikhail Stepanov and Harald Schlegelmilch. The pro class in the championship now, Patrick Kujala, 45 points to the 32 of Sergio Campana and Fabrizio Crestani. Eduardo Liberati is then with Patrick Niederhauser on 25 points, not scoring today. Florian Spengler comes next ahead of another troubled combo, that of Giacomo Barry and Alberto Cerqui. Mavlanov and Zampieri getting some points finally. They are next ahead of Isaac Tutumlu, who in turn is just behind Alberto De Falco, his aggressor from that fourth round of the championship. Travalza, Cozzolino and Michimi come next. So those drivers in the Pro Cup, all of course in the Huracans, the Gallardos only for AMs this year, an AM class. So we have, I think, everybody just about ready for the second of the podiums. And there'll be the winning team as well in each class. It'll be Conrad, I think I'm right in saying, yes, for Pro-Am honours, because you're going to have their Adrian Amstutz. But first of all, the third place drivers, namely Mikhail Stepanov and Harald Schlegelmilch, head out onto the podium. Harald back into circuit racing this year after a few seasons in rallying after his Formula 3 career came to an end. He will go to the third step on the podium then. So you've got Stepanov and Schlegelmilch for third. For second place, out come Kelvin Snooks and the burlier frame of Mikko Eskelinen. And the top step will go the way of Adrian Amstutz, who has been a very, very good driver for this man, Franz Conrad. And because Adrian Amstutz's car stopped out on the side of the road, then Franz Conrad it is who will represent Adrian Amstutz on the top step of the podium. The ever-smiling, ever-enthusiastic Franz Conrad, very busy running cars in Porsche Championships such as Carrera Cup Deutschland, but new this year to the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo. And the third-place trophies come, first of all, to Harald Schlegelmilch and to a very successful Russian touring car racer, Mikhail Stepanov there. Then for second place, Mikko Eskelinen, Mr. Mad Croc, and Calvin Snooks, former single-seater racer. And then Franz Conrad masquerading as Adrian Amstutz gets the winner's trophy. I think he might claim the clock if there's one on offer for the Pro-Am winners as well. And there's a Pirelli trophy, I think, also to be given to Franz Conrad. But no one steps forward as yet. There should be, I think, a Pirelli trophy for each class winner, but it's not been quite a slick for Franz Conrad. Anyway, there it is. So another excellent trophy and a Pirelli cap as well for Franz Conrad. Which, all of this, of course, has to be given back to Adrian Amstutz in due course. And then they get together, but Franz Conrad says, look, I'm not a driver, you just go on, you have your photos taken, I'll get out of the way. But the winning team, represented by Franz Conrad, former Formula 3 champion, part of Silk Cut Jaguar operation in Group C days many, many years ago, and a hugely enthusiastic supporter of motorsport is Franz Conrad. There is champagne to be sprayed. Mikko Eskelinen then soaks anybody he can find and then gets a face full for his troubles. So the Finn with Kelvin Snooks this year as his co-driver. Those two making a good partnership, third in the class. And with Adrian Amstutz's car having stopped by the side of the road, he's unable to get himself to the podium in time, so that's why you've had Franz Conrad being up there taking the place of his driver. So we have two more podium ceremonies still. The AMS will be next, and then the Gallardo drivers to come. So they can see the trophies at the back of the podium, ready and waiting. And as soon as we get the nod from the officials, then out will come the drivers. So all these drivers part of a rejuvenated Lamborghini program. It's the Lamborghini Squadra Corsa now looking after motorsport activities. And in the championship, Adrian Amstutz, Mikko Eskelinen and Kelvin Snooks all tied on 38 points ahead of Matteo Bobby and Jay Palmer and Marco Moscato and Loris Spinelli, just one ahead of Raffaele Giannone. 4 points back, Harald Schlegelmilch and Mikhail Stepanov with Kai Cozzolino and Shinya Michimi next. The AM podium is underway and it is started by the Portuguese driver Eugenio and Sergio Montes out onto the podium. For second place, Mark Inaiken. And then the top step goes the way of the Georgian driver Shota Abkazava. Abkazava, who owns circuits, runs teams, runs championships, races, sponsors drivers, a great sort of impresario of Russian motorsport. So Shota Abkhazava, the Georgian driver, is the man on the top step. Rare you've heard that played at Silverstone, or anywhere, I suspect, in the past at a motorsport event. But Shota Abkhazava flying the flag almost literally here for his home state. So for Eugenio Sergio Montes, the trophy's given for third place. Second at the other end of the podium is Marky Nyken, whose brother Rolf is a very successful Conrad Porsche racer. And then for the top step of the podium, Shota Abkhazava, who has this year certainly come on a pace, know the circuit better, and being a real character as well within the championship. And then the drivers getting themselves together, ready for photographs. There's one more, Shota Abkhazava is told, and that's the Pirelli trophy. And now both aloft, it's all smiles. Then people get together on the top step. And congratulations to the winning drivers. Another excellent effort put in here by Abkhazava with the Artline Team Georgia entry. It's the same team that runs the Stepanov and Schlegelmilch car. But Shota Abkhazava is going to keep or spray the champagne. He's going to keep. The Montes brothers want to spray. They want to play. Shota Abkhazava is a gentleman, but go on then, he says. Yes. The champagne is sprayed. And the Montes, who've not been on the podium before in the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo, want their moment. But I think Shota Abkhazava has enjoyed himself as well. A clink of the bottles, and they will make their way off the podium as the final three teams will be up, namely those from the Gallardo competition. A win in the class for Andrews Josephson and for Ricardo Vera, new to the championship this weekend. Cyril Lima second, and then third going the way of Nima Kandanir and Jake Rattenbury, the two Brits. This is how the Huracan Am Cup looks, with Shota Abkhazava leading Mark Kienijken. Then it's Eugenio and Sergio Montes ahead of Jürgen Krebs. The absent Michael Schaal and Siegfried Van Emmer come next ahead of Tim Richards. Then it's Mikhail Spidorinov and Laurent Jenny, Cedric Lima and newcomer Christoph Lenz. So onto the podium has already come Nima Kandanir and Jake Rattenbury. Now also has come Cyril Lima, and now it is Andrews Josephson and Ricardo Vera for the top step of the podium. And the winning team's national anthem is now to be played. So the podium is done for the Gallardo drivers, with Andrews Josephson and Ricardo Vera taking class honours, and an excellent weekend for the two of them. Ricardo Vera new to the championship, but a second win of the weekend as that Nima Kandanir and Jake Rattenbury take third place. Cyril Lima, another stalwart Lamborghini racer, taking second spot. And then the top step for Andrews Josephson and Ricardo Vera. Ricardo, who's done limited car racing, coming out of karting. Andrews Josephson, we first saw in the championship at the back end of two seasons ago, and goes strongly, getting more experience all the time. So they huddle together on the top step, and happy drivers all round then in this, the fourth round of the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo. A race that lost Cyril Lima early on the opening lap, I think it was, with an incident. We also had a fair bit of mechanical damage for one or two cars, and incidents aplenty when the rain came down. But Patrick Koyala it is who is victorious once again here at Silverstone as the Gallardo Ams spray the champagne. Let's have a look at some of the best bits of round four. On a dry track, the race got underway from the traditional rolling start. nervous faces in the pit garage as a storming start put Koyala into the lead, and straight away Patrick Niederhauser had problems, the car slipping down the field as he turned through cops, and it got no better. The field worked its way through club corner and he was losing places hand over fist, and after three laps gave up the unequal struggle, pitted into retirement. Florian Spengler had a very big spin before the pit stop window opened. On the pit stops, Mavlinov took over the lead but was slow out, and that enabled Koyala to overtake him. Mikhail Spidorinov went off the road, so also did Neil Huggins. He had this big lose going through Cops Corner. But with the road being greasy, others were being caught out. Not, however, Shota Abkhazava, because the Georgian hung on to lead his class. Jürgen Krebs was on target for fourth in his and 14th place overall. Alberto Di Folco was getting stuck in to try and find a way past Florian Spengler, but he then copped a 1 second stop-go penalty for too short a pit stop. He had gained the place around the outside at Kops. Little good did it do him. Eventually, Di Folco made contact with Isaac Tutumlu coming down towards Village. Both cars off the road and Di Folco out with damage. Patrick Koyala then makes it now 4 out of 4. The next stop is Paul Ricard. From David Addison at Silverstone, bye for now.